Hi.
Hi. How are you?
I'm okay. How are you?
I'm all right.
You're all right. Back from the moon.
Back from the moon. Exactly. Back from the moon.
Do you feel a responsibility of being a representative of NASA and all things space for a period of time of your life now?
I felt an intense responsibility while we were working. I have to say, maybe more so than anything I've worked on, just because Neil was such an icon, and because I knew what we were saying was provocative. And not provocative in a Walter White, you know, this guy, you know, is a lunatic kind of
world.
But provocative in a, you know, we were really trying to say something deep about the program and about the cost of the program, especially on families. And about the intense sacrifice, and showing that this was not all, you know, rah-rah triumphalism.
So where did it start for you? What was the first call or the first read or the first whatever?
I got a call from Damien, from Temple Hill, really, saying, would you like to meet with Damien about this project? And I was actually at a pretty dark moment. Fifth Estate had come out and not done well at all with the critics or at the box office. Spotlight, we'd had a huge movie star attached to play Robbie, two actually, one to play Robbie, one to play Mike, and both of them had jumped ship. And so we were nowhere. I mean, Tommy and I were working on the script, but, you know, and he said, well, we'll get it cast, but I didn't know. I mean, I knew he was committed, which was huge because, you know, I love Tommy because he's a great director, but, you know, we had tried to get the movie made the previous year and had no success. So I was at a pretty low point, and I was really looking for a job. And my agents called and said, Temple Hill wants you to come in and meet with Damien Chazelle, and Whiplash had just been at Sundance. So, and I knew very little about Neil Armstrong other than what I learned as a boy.
Right.
And so I said, I don't know, let me look at this movie. And they sent me under lock and key, Whiplash, on a DVD. And my wife and I watched it and were just blown away. And I basically, at that point, whatever, he could have pitched anything to me and I would have said yes. Because I was so taken with him as a filmmaker. We got a soundtrack.
Yeah, we're going to have a rhythm track of this.
Pretty good. So I was so taken with him as a filmmaker. And then he started describing to me what he had picked up from reading Jim's book. what is going on back there?
I figure we're good for another minute or so of that before
This is a whole thing. They've got... It's a fancy BMW i8, and they're blasting the clearly they're very excited about their new car.
I can imagine. They're about to meet the new neighbors.
There we go.
That's right.
It's hilarious. So, you know, it's funny. You go from, you know, having the you know, anyway.
you got a little off track there on the rhythm track.
Sorry. Back in.
So you were suffering.
So I was suffering, and I get this call from Damien, and I didn't know much about Neil, and you know, in that first meeting, Damien told me one thing that blew my mind, which is that Neil had a daughter he lost, which I had never known. And, you know, it's one of those things, I mean, it really struck me last week when George H.W. Bush died, and, you know, you'd think they would have spent all their time talking about his CIA past, his... past, you know, his job as the vice president, as the president, you know, how he rose to such prominence. But all I heard was about this three-year-old daughter he'd lost, right, which I had never known about, and how he prayed for her every day, right? Which just goes to show the difference between the private and the public, and just goes to show how powerful these things are when they happen and defining.
Well, it's funny because when you said that about Armstrong and not knowing... Why would you back then? Nowadays, you know everything about everybody all the time.
It's true, although I had never known about George H.W.
Right, but I mean, he was that pre-internet era.
I guess so.
Now everybody's examining.
Yeah, I mean, but to me, it's fascinating that, you know, I mean, Neil didn't die that long ago.
Right.
We didn't hear about Karen when Neil died, right?
Yep.
Like, So
people still had respect for other people's privacy, kind of.
Well, no, again, he died in like 2 years ago, 3 years ago.
Right.
So it's not like he died just before I started on the project in 2012. So I don't know that it was such a privacy change as much as it was Neil was such a private person.
Right.
And Neil was not putting this stuff into the world, and neither was his family. And so, you know, that fact alone, you know, just sucked me in. And then when I started reading Jim's book, and I realized that within 12 months, Neil lost, you know, two of his best friends in Gemini, right? Mm-hmm. Elliot C. and Ed White. And then it turns out he also lost Joe Walker. Joe Walker also died in that period, who we don't show his death, but we meet him. That's Brian D'Arcy James plays him in the movie. He was Neil's boss, direct boss at Edwards at FRC, and someone Neil was very close to. And in that same 12 months, you know, 2 weeks after Elliot dies, Neil almost dies in Gemini 8. Mm-hmm. When I read about that year, I was just staggered by how painful it must have been. And it also made me realize, wow, you know, poor Janet, right? Who, you know, I mean, she was super close with Pat White. Mm-hmm. And she sees how that destroys Pat. And then, you know, in the wake of having almost lost Neil once, has to watch him go all the way to the moon. I mean, you know, it really hit home, you know, what Gene Cernan's wife always says, which is, you think it's hard going to the moon, try staying home. And so I think that Damien and I both became pretty obsessed with how different the stories were than what we had been told. How different the portrait of the era was, in fact, in Jim's book, than this triumphalist narrative that is what we basically have seen. That the myth, you know, and the storytelling of the past was actually, you know, off about 30%. And so the idea of trying to put forward a different narrative of the space program, a different narrative of the astronauts, you know. And by the way, it's what Tom Wolfe tried to do originally with The Right Stuff, when he basically, you know, I mean, a lot of the astronauts hated The Right Stuff, the book, because Tom Wolfe, you know, said, what you see in Life magazine is propaganda. Now, Wolfe was much more focused on the tawdry, right, which wasn't as interesting to us, and there wasn't much tawdry in Neil's life. But, you know, he also, to a lesser extent, got at the pain. That's what was interesting to us, you know, was how different that part was from the propaganda in life.
So do you dig into Wolf immediately, or when you're interested in this? Or?
No, I mean, Wolf, you know, is more background, right? Because Wolf really just covers Mercury. And we were much more interested in Neil. So my primary, you know, after reading the book, my primary focus was really going deep on Neil and starting with Jim and his book, right? Which is, you know, I mean, he got 55 hours with Neil, which is more than anyone got with Neil. And then also spent time with June, his sister, and Janet, and the boys, and then all the astronauts as well. But the difference with Jim, you know, a lot of these astronaut historians mostly just spent time with the astronauts, and Jim really went into the family and went into the family dynamics. And then what was great was that Jim then, you know, introduced us to the family. So we got to spend time with Mark and Rick and Janet and go deep there. And we got to spend, you know, a little bit of time with June, and we went out to Cincinnati a couple times and you know, felt like we really got underneath the hood of Neil a little bit through the family. Carol Armstrong was also helpful. And then, you know, we also did what Jim did in terms of the colleagues. You know, we spent time with Mike Collins. We spent time with Dave Scott. We spent time with, you know, other folks who knew and worked with Neil, Frank Hughes, who was a huge technical advisor for us, who was the head of astronaut training when he left NASA. You know, Joe Engel, who was the last living guy to fly the X-15, huge help with the X-15 section. Al Warden. I mean, we just had a cadre of experts. But for us, and we needed it, right? Because, you know, on two levels, this movie was incredibly ambitious. One was, you know, the technical, right, and getting that right and accurate, which is just mind-bendingly hard. to understand what's going on, especially because there are some things where you're just overwhelmed by all the information. Apollo, you know, between the Lunar Flight Journal and the Lunar Surface Journal and, you know, First Men on the Moon and all the books there are and all the, you know, the enormity of the transcripts. It's a ton of material. So just being able to sift through is a huge challenge. And then trying to figure out how to stay faithful to the material while also communicating what you need to the viewers, right? So that's challenge. That's a challenge on one side, and then the challenge on the other side is something like, you know, Gemini 8, the mission control sequences, where there aren't actual, you know, comms. There's no flight director for mission control during Gemini. Mm-hmm. So I had to literally work with Jerry Griffin, who was a flight controller in the room during Gemini 8, and tease out what everyone would be saying in that room, because Damien was shooting it documentary style, and so I had to write 40 pages of additional dialogue, because, you know, he didn't know where the camera was going to be, so I had to have everybody talking when we're in those rooms.
And did you know what ultimately would end up in the movie, or was that kind of an
I knew very little what ultimately end up in the movie, but I had no idea which portion.
Right.
So that's why 40 pages. If I could just script the, you know, 5 minutes that we're going to end up. I mean, I knew what the scenes were.
Right.
So in other words, there are five scenes in Mission Control, and I knew what those scenes were, but I didn't know who Damien was going to be on during those scenes, because he was going to shoot a documentary style like Flight 93 and the flight, you know, the flight control.
Well, you hear this with actors on certain sets where, you know, they're all have to be on all the time because you don't know where the camera's going to pop up and all that.
Right.
I've never heard it from a screenwriter before.
Right. Well,
that's interesting.
Well, and specifically here, because there couldn't be ad lib. You know, this was a room of flight controllers, right? They couldn't just, like, make stuff up, right? So Damien kept saying, and literally I put this off as long as I possibly could because I kept hoping he would change his mind on how he was going to shoot it. But he kept saying, like, I need to know what every one of the guys at the 8 desks is going to be saying. We didn't even know there were 8 decks. He's like, I need to know what every one of the guys in the room is going to be saying.
Right.
So I had to work with Jerry and say, okay, who are the main 8 guys? And what are they saying in each of these 5 moments? So, you know, that's 8 guys times 5 moments. So I need, you know, dialogue, you know, of, you know, 40 different. So it's, you know, about a page of dialogue for each of those, for each guy in each moment. Right. Hence the 40 pages of which, you know, teeny bit kind of ends up in the movie. But so the technical really span the gamut. Right. And then on the other side, just getting underneath Neil, who was this emotionally tightly packaged individual, as Jim says repeatedly throughout his book, and this incredibly private individual, very, very challenging.
So how much as you go through this process and you have access and you're talking to people and you're meeting people, how loose, I mean, obviously their details are going to change, but how loose is the script or the story of the script while you're in that process? Could it have changed dramatically, completely, or was it you guys kind of honed in to the idea of what the movie was and you were filling in the weight of it?
So we knew the beginning and the ending and the midpoint, right? So we knew very quickly we coalesced around this idea of opening on that X-15 flight, just because, you know, most people don't know that Neil flew for NASA before he flew for NASA, right? That he was working up at Edwards, you know, at Flight Research Center for NASA before he joined Gemini and Apollo. And that, you know, at Flight Research Center, he flew the only, you know, the highest flying, fastest space plane we ever flew. It's funny. I was just watching. They did the successful flight of Virgin Galactic, and it's a very similar plane. It operates in a very, very similar way. It's taken up to about 40,000 feet. You know, just like the X-15 was. The X-15 was on a bomber, right? A B-2 bomber. But whereas the Virgin Galactic, they have their own sort of like carry plane that carries up their rocket plane, their version of the X-15, and they drop it, right, just like the X-15 was dropped, and then it lights a rocket and goes on a ballistic trajectory, which is the same thing the X-15 did, right? And so goes into, and in fact, the X-15 pilots used to routinely go above 50 miles, which is what the Virgin Galactic plane did today. They went even higher. They went up to, I think, 62 miles. And anything over 50 miles, at least NASA calls it space and would give them astronaut wings. Neil didn't get quite that high. He got up to 200,000 feet on this flight. But that's still suborbital, right?
Right.
So, and moreover, it's, you know, so things float in the cabin, right? And also what's really wild about it is that you're coming down without any engine. You're gliding that thing down. And, you know, the X-15 at least glides like a brick. Like it had a 3-to-1 lift drag ratio, which, you know, just to give you context, like a commercial airliner, if all its engines cut out, it would have a 20-to-1 lift drag ratio, meaning it glides better than this did,
right?
So this thing's coming down like a brick and you got to figure out how to land it. And typically you basically go down in a spiral, so you throw off energy and slow down the plane and at the last minute pull out and then do a flare, right? Because Neil had on this particular flight flown all the way, you know, 20 miles downrange, he had to come straight in, which was incredibly hard. So, you know, this was a pretty dangerous situation. You know, at the very least, it's shocking that he didn't lose the plane, let alone, you know, die himself. So I found the plane fascinating, but also the fact that Neil screwed up. And this was one of three screw-ups in the course of a month, right around the time that his daughter died. And so to show the greatest living pilot, you know, screwing up, right? And to show that it was because he was affected emotionally, that just felt like a really interesting place to start the movie and to start talking about cost and sacrifice and how it relates to, you know, a mission.
And did you have any interest in aviation before all this started?
No, but I have a ton now.
You do. You obviously know what you're talking about.
It's funny because I was not a great flyer for a very long time, and I still am not a terrific flyer. But oddly, an old girlfriend gave me a flight lesson, which I took and loved because I love being out the controls, which is clearly what it's all about for me. But
which Hollywood screenwriters generally, that's a defining characteristic. Yeah.
Exactly. But if they want to be at the controls, they should direct, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But
they're in control until they give away the script.
But you know, I have to say this process of studying flight has helped me a little bit. I mean, I still want to be at the controls, but now
you know what's actually happening.
I have a better sense, and I feel, you know, I'm like, we have, you know, if all the engines cut out, I could probably, I know how to flare the plane, right? So I just found that machine fascinating, that X-15 aircraft. Mm-hmm. I found that moment, you know, fascinating. And Neil always referred to his time up at Edwards as some of his favorite time in the world. And so starting at Juniper Hill, starting right before Karen died, you know, so we knew we were going to start there, and we knew we were going to end roughly around the moon, and we knew that the Gemini 8 mission was just a spectacular midpoint, you know, action sequence. So we knew what our tent poles were as, but you know, within that framework, you know, a lot changed, and we did all sorts of micro tuning. You know, one of the things I like to do with a script like this is to give it out to the people we're working with. Mark Rick Armstrong read two drafts. Janet Armstrong was read a draft by Rick and walked through. Mike Collins read two drafts. Dave Scott read a bunch of drafts and beat us up pretty good at the outset. You know,
because
You know, frankly, because a lot of stuff was wrong.
So was it detail stuff or emotional stuff initially?
Both. I mean, you know, I think emotionally, I think a lot of folks, you know, weren't particularly keen on showing Neil, you know, upset by his daughter's death, right? You know, that's something that, you know, all these guys were used to just sort of like pushing down the emotions and moving on. And just like Neil did, and we show him doing that, we just also show you what he's actually feeling, because to not feel it, he'd be a robot, right? Which he very clearly wasn't. So that he found challenging, but also technically we had all sorts of stuff wrong. You know, and a good example is, you know, the first time I did the moon landing, I was much more concerned about telling the story of the moon landing than I was in being faithful to the Collins.
You had to go plant that flag immediately.
We'll get to that. I'm happy to talk about that in a minute. We really wanted to explain, like, oh, they're out of fuel. Right. Oh, there are these things happening that make it really dicey. And, you know, people would read that and be like, that's not what they said. And so I actually went back and I threw out my entire, you know, lunar landing sequence. And I went back to exactly what was said in transcript. Now, the tough thing about that is they say 94 seconds to bingo. They don't say 114 seconds to mandatory abort. So I would take a moment like 94 seconds to bingo and add in this other line, right? But what I did was I tried to use only comms and only add in lines when absolutely necessary. You know, another good example is, you know, 1201. You know, we've got a 1201 alarm. You know, what you don't hear is that Neil and Buzz had no idea what that was, because there were so many different alarms, right. They had no idea what that was. And so that very well could have been in a command to abort, right? So to get across like how nerve-wracking that moment is, we add, you know, a little couplet. Right. But I really tried to be much more faithful, because I knew that would be important to the people. You know, there were going to be, you know, space historians were going to watch this, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're literally trying to make an argument. You know, Jim Hansen has been trying to make an argument with his book, which is that the history, the way we see this history is wrong. It's triumphalist in a way that it shouldn't be. That the meta narrative around the space program, you know, that mm-hmm. it was easy, is bullshit. It was super hard. And moreover, I think that meta-narrative has really, you know, hurt us in terms of we think things like climate change should be easy. Right. No, they're going to be hard. They're going to require a lot of sacrifice, right? And so, you know, to me, it was very important to get the technical stuff right mm-hmm. so that we would be able to bring the historians along for this other point of view on the emotional history of the program. And so we worked really, really hard on it. And, you know, look, you know, in the end of the day, like, I'm happy to report, you know, not only were Mark and Rick happy with the movie, as has been documented, and thought we captured everything pretty accurately, but, you know, the senior curator at the Smithsonian wrote, you know, of space history at the Smithsonian, this guy Michael Neufeld wrote an article on the day we came out saying it's the most accurate, you know, most historically accurate space movie ever made. You know, and that was what we were going for, again, because we saw this as in part a contribution to the history. And I have to say, it's one of the reasons that the flag controversy was so galling. And I mean, look, I don't see it as a silly controversy. I understand, right?
People. Well, I saw it as a silly controversy initially because they had not seen the movie. I mean, that was the first crazy part of it.
Right,
it was a bunch of people screaming who had not seen the picture at all.
Right. And moreover, I think if they had seen the picture, they would have seen it's actually pretty intensely patriotic.
Right.
But
and there's context for every. I mean, it's not like you do everything but that.
Correct.
And avoid it. It's that you're focusing on something else.
Yeah, we're focusing on something else. And in some ways, you know, I guess we worked so hard to get this right. I mean, in fact, I wrote a whole book. I wrote this annotated screenplay, so which, by the way, nobody's written about, which is a little bit aggravating. But so I wrote, you know, so we have the entire script in here, and then we have Jim Hansen, the biographer, and I. We talk through every scene and talk about, give historical context, because there's a ton. But we also then talk about where we take license and why.
Right.
And we don't take a lot of license, but we take a little, and we want to sort of detail it, one, for the historical record, but two, because I think screenwriters need to talk about this. Like, I think we have a tremendous responsibility when we make these movies in terms of the factuality. Now, why am I getting so upset about, like, you know, the facts in movies when the facts in the real world seem to be under such, you know, siege?
Maybe that's why.
but that is why. I think there is an issue when we are fast and loose with the spirit of what happened, we change the myth, we change the story, we change the narrative. And these myths, you know, the myths we make as movie makers, if we're lucky, they survive for a long, long time, right? And so I feel like there is a tremendous responsibility, especially when you're dealing with something that is supposedly well-known, right? And when you're actually attacking the well-known myth, I think there's a tremendous responsibility to get it right. You know, to do the hard work. And so what was very frustrating about, you know, the flag controversy was exactly that, you know, the know-nothing culture, right? And all these people speaking out about the movie who hadn't seen the movie. And, you know, and in fact, we had worked hard, so hard to get it right. You know, the fact that we could be, and there's no question to me that the box office was damaged. You know, there's no question that, you know, that the middle of the country could have been $5-10 million on opening weekend, which, you know, you can play out through the multiple, right? You know, that you know, we didn't pick up in the middle of the country because, you know, I literally would get email after email of people, well, my friends, I'm going to see the movie, my friends aren't because of X, Y, and Z, because of the flag thing. And to me, you know, we were trying to create a picture that was not a red state picture or a blue state picture, but a picture of, hey, this is... this is what it really took to make America great, right?
Right.
This kind of sacrifice. And by the way, if we want to really make America great again, this is the kind of thing we're going to have to do, this kind of sacrifice, this kind of hard work.
Mm-hmm.
And to have, in some ways, the very people we're making the argument against be able to dismiss the movie without having seen it.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's the Ted Cruz's and the Donald Trump's of the world, right? That we really are trying to say, no. Those guys are actually selling you a bill of goods.
Right.
Right? Like, that's actually, what they're selling is actually wrong, right? You can't just, you know, you can't make America great again by snapping your fingers. You have to sacrifice. You have to do what these guys did, what Neil did, what Janet did. You know, you have to, you know, be willing to put yourself to one side for the good of your country and for the good of the people around you. So,
what must be particularly galling for Damien is that, as you know, the year before he got kind of nailed for not being progressive enough somehow,
right.
And now he's getting nailed for somehow not being, you know, right wing enough.
Well,
it's
neither. Right.
Neither
exactly.
Movie was political.
Exactly.
I mean, I don't think La La Land was political. I don't think this movie is political. I mean, except that everything is political, but
I think it's
a movie about a person.
I think it's political with a small p.
Yeah.
Right? It's not political in terms of, like, it's
left
political
and
with small, right, in terms of left and white. It's political with a small p in terms of what kind of country do we want, right? And if we want to be a country that achieves great things, clearly we're going to have to sacrifice, right? Which, again, you know, we seem to not be of an era that is asking what they can do for their country as opposed to what their country can do for them.
Yeah.
And I think we're going to have to flip that around again, like Kennedy suggested, if we are to tackle, you know, things like climate change and, you know, and income inequality and other great challenges.
There was a great New Yorker piece that I still haven't found, but I'm going to look for more about the a little bit into the Trump run, but before he, you know, won the nomination or the presidency, about how something like this can only happen when the country is actually in pretty good shape, that it's actually, there's like a comfort zone,
right,
and that the amount of anger and the amount of frustration that is being expressed by people is the frustration of people who are actually okay, mostly.
Right.
And the people who are really suffering are not angry that way, but if that, you know, that we're somehow, the comfort zone allows us to be really angry about really minor issues, and we lose track of the bigger issues because they're much harder to deal with.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I guess, I'm not sure. I mean, I think it's, the country is clearly going through great change and has been for a little while now, thanks to technology, thanks to, you know, some wonderful developments in terms of civil rights, it's a different country than it was. Right.
It's
exactly.
Changing.
Exactly.
The color changes.
Exactly. And so it's a
as it has forever.
Right. And so it's a different country now than it was 20 years ago. And
yeah.
So some folks, you know, who relied on things being a certain way are seeing, you know, the world change around them.
Yeah.
And, you know, and to some degree, like, we need to do better in terms of helping those people navigate that change. And to some degree, people need to suck it up. Right?
Well, and Armstrong was really, I mean, as he is in this movie, not an unusual man, a special man, but very much the way men tend to deal with things like this.
Yeah.
He's an old-fashioned man. He is
right.
Not a he's not a modern guy who's got his heart on his sleeve.
Right. Right.
He's, you know, he holds it in,
right,
and which makes the ending of it all the more powerful.
Right.
And so when you say you knew the ending, obviously you knew where he went.
Right.
But did you know that what was going to happen on the moon was what your focus was going
to
be?
We knew that we were going to try to make the moon a very personal moment. We knew that we were going to try. We knew that it was a movie about grief, and that the moment on the moon, in some way, was going to be a moment of release. That thing he does on the moon is something that Jim sort of wrote about in his book. He doesn't have proof of it, but it's his belief and
mm-hmm.
June Armstrong's belief that it certainly might have happened. And so, June Hoffman, I should say, Neil's sister, that it certainly might have happened, and that was certainly good enough for us.
So how did the idea, I mean, the idea had to come from somewhere, before them.
Oh, you know, well, so, you know, this was not...
Their notion of it happening came from somewhere, I assume.
It's not atypical for astronauts to leave things on the moon, mementos right. of loved ones or lost ones. Charlie Duke left a photo of his family on the moon, literally just sitting on the moon. That's probably, you know, a little faded by now, yeah. but...
a lot of sunlight.
Neil and Buzz left a pouch with an Apollo 1 patch and two medallions for Gagarin and Komarov, the two cosmonauts who had died. Mm-hmm. So this sort of thing was done. And Jim actually asked Neil if he had left anything of Karen's on the moon. Neil denied it, but then when Jim asked for the contents of his PPK, his personal preference kit, which is where you keep all your private mm-hmm. items that you're taking, Neil said he had lost it, which didn't really sound like Neil. And it turns out, it actually, he hadn't lost it. It's in the archive at Purdue under seal until 2020.
Wow.
So Jim, you know, was curious and so asked June the question. And June said, I think, you know, do you think he left something of Karen's on the moon? And June said, I dearly hope so. Because June was one of the ones who had told Jim how incredibly devastating as, you know, of course it would be, but how incredibly devastating it was for Neil to lose Karen. And so... you know, it was one of these things where it was, again, it's conjecture, but it felt like reasonable conjecture.
It was the emotionally the story you weren't telling.
Yeah, I mean, you know, again, it's such, you know, and look, the movie is pretty atypical, right, in terms of a hero's arc, right? We start him at a pretty bad place.
Mm-hmm.
And then he starts to find his way back, joining Gemini, and then just gets knocked down and knocked down and knocked down. He loses Elliot, he almost dies, he loses Ed, right? And he just has to close himself off and withdraw, right?
Mm.
You know, to me, in some ways, the most shocking thing was the fact that the boys were behind us, which meant we had to be in the ballpark, because it's not exactly the prettiest family portrait in the world, right? But, you know, clearly he became, you know, I mean, Janet would say Neil was not one to share, you know, the boys would say, you know, Rick would say often you'd ask him a question, you just wouldn't get an answer. Janet would say that no was a huge argument from Neil, just the word, you know. So clearly there was a big, clearly there wound up being a chasm as he went through this program. And so... you know, the movie is all about, like, how do you manage... It's a very internal movie. It's about how do you mm-hmm. manage these emotions, you know, when you need to push them down in order to go forward. And so we always wanted the moon to be, you know, this Orpheus moment of he gets to Hades, you know, and tries to reclaim what he can't reclaim and then has to realize he has to let it go. This moment of, you know... It's all when you set yourself a huge task, there's always this odd thing of like when you achieve it. Mm. Like, that's weird. For so long, I've been trying, chasing this thing, and now I have it. And how does that feel? Not to mention, just
you're doing that like you're holding an Oscar, by the way. I'm saying.
That's hilarious. But just the oddness of, you know, I'll hold this book. How's that, you know? But just the oddness of also just being on this other body looking back at Earth. Right, and what kind of perspective does that give you? And so, you know, the word that kept coming to my mind was oddness, you know, the oddness of it all. Mm-hmm. And Damien, you know, pointed to that, you know, word in the script. And I think in some ways the entire movie, you know, the whole movie is like this in 16, and then you get to the moon, and handheld, and then you get to the moon, mm-hmm. and not only are you in IMAX, right, but you're also then in wides and longs, and you're on a Steadicam, right? It's a totally different... It's supposed to make you feel that thing, and mm-hmm. and to some degree, like the movie is, you know, it's this, you know, it's this crescendo to then a total shift in point of view. So, so we were always the movie was always supposed to be all about the moon, not only but emotionally. Right, yeah. As opposed to emotionally, visually, but also emotionally in terms of getting you to a place emotionally, getting you to feel something emotionally that might be somewhat akin to what he might have felt.
Mm. Well, it's interesting in the mythology of these movies and the right stuff, I mean, in some ways, he's probably closest to Jaeger in that group of people, and yet he doesn't have the personality. You know, he's like a completely different personality.
Closest but there's to that Jaeger, same, how so?
In the kind of taciturn, you know, like, I'm going to go do my job, you know. There's not a lot of riding in the desert chasing his girlfriend or wife or whatever, but it's very, a lot of this movie is people going to work.
Yeah.
And going and doing the thing they've decided to do.
Yeah.
And focusing and not, like, not being distracted by the idea of being astronauts, not being distracted. I mean, there's a little bit of it in his partner in the craft.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's like, he's just going and doing the thing he does.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
doing it well.
Yeah.
And bad things happen and good things happen. And
yeah.
But the thing that most matters is the emotional, ultimately the heart that beats underneath of all that is, yeah. Comes from his daughter's loss.
Yeah.
The loss of his daughter.
Yeah. And the loss of the others. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I definitely think that there's a line, we threw in a couple great Neil quotes in here. My favorite is the one we start the book with, which says, we all like to be recognized not for one piece of fireworks, but for the ledger of our daily work, which is just a great quote. And yeah. And to some degree, we were trying to show the challenge of that ledger for Neil.
Well, you know, I grew up in Florida, so I saw astronauts often.
Oh, yeah.
Because we're all very sociable. He was not.
No,
I that was not know, his thing. But, like, we'd see Grissom, and we didn't see Grissom, yeah. but we saw, you know, we saw these guys repeatedly at right. different things. They right. turn up and they were all, you know, it was all Jack Nicholson and
yeah
and all that.
No, it's it, you know, there definitely was that culture, and Neil was definitely not really a part of it, but I think, you know, one of the reasons for that culture was, as a way, if I had to guess, was because they were storing so much up, it was just blowing off steam, you know. It was a way to, like, not deal with the challenge of their daily life.
I'd be really curious to see the movie about the next 30 years of his life.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting.
It's got to be fascinating.
Because, you know, we had you know, I wrote a couple scenes that had to do with that, and they wound up not making the movie. You know, one of them, you know, was this, you know, here's a guy who didn't particularly love the press, you know, and he was very good at it because he was very good at everything when pressed, but he didn't love, you know, doing that. And, you know, he comes back and he's told that he's not going to fly again. I mean, not told, but it's understood mm-hmm. that he's not going to fly again. And moreover, the next thing he has to do is a, you know, 55 country tour, you know, and he's got to be this icon. And I had a scene of him having to go out and face the press after being told that he's not going to fly again. And, you know, I got to imagine that was incredibly challenging. Yeah. And also, again, given how private he was, you know, to have the whole world. I mean, he was getting 10,000 pieces of mail a day for a while. So there is probably.
And did he look at them?
Do you know? He tried to respond to as much as he could.
Wow.
Because that's the kind of guy he was. Yeah. So I think it was, you know, it's interesting because I think, you know, one of the other things we ran into turbulence-wise when we gave the script out to folks is Neil changed, I think, quite a bit in his later years. And I've talked to his sons about this, you know, and you can attribute it. I mean, so Janet left him, not until the 90s, like 20 years after, mm-hmm. but she left him. And she left him, and she said, I couldn't deal with the personality anymore. and he was devastated. He tried to get her back, and she just was done. And then, like, a year or two later, he met Carol Armstrong, who was this beautiful, charming, super smart. I mean, she's just terrific. And I think the combination of those two events brought him out of his shell a little bit, changed him, Carol would say she made him loosen up a little bit, take himself less seriously. And I think the boys would probably attribute that more to Janet leaving him and that being a wake-up call. But either way, you know, so the Neil that a lot of these guys got to know later was looser and you know, not quite as, you know, serious and focused. And he always had this incredible wit. And I think, you know, the later Neil probably had it on display a little more easily.
I don't think it's a studio movie, but I do think the idea of, because every movie, whether it's a sports movie or astronauts or people who are heroes,
yeah,
you know, ultimately every movie is about them, you know, coming up against the odds, something happens, puts them back, and they somehow come back and do the thing they were meant to do.
Right.
But you never see the movie about what happens when they, you know, when the leg gets broken, Joe Theismann's leg gets broken, and he never gets to play again.
Right, sure.
And I think that would actually be a fascinating, I guess an indie probably, but a kind of a fascinating story, because
sure.
the idea of having all that and it being gone in an instant, whether it's by
sure.
coming down from your sure. flight or having an injury or whatever it is, sure. is a big emotional
yeah Friday Night Lights
switch.
Right?
Yeah,
but sort of, but not quite
kids,
in the same way.
You know, but yeah. that's a, it's yeah, it's a different.
But no question, and no question, there's something interesting there. Although I would say, you know, I would quibble just a little bit. You know, I mean, I guess this is a big studio movie. Right?
This I'm not saying, yeah.
But I mean, which you said, I guess the thing is that the thing I would say would be, and it's more of a question, you know, what do we want our big Hollywood studio movies to be like? You know, and it's where, you know, I think one of the reasons I feel so passionately about this movie is because this is what I want our Hollywood studio movies to be. You know, I want our Hollywood studios movies to be ambitious. Damien was trying to make something akin to a 70s epic. I think mm-hmm. he succeeded. But whether you think he succeeded or not, the ambition of the vision and the what he's trying to do directorially, to me, is I don't know that there are that many directors who are doing that right now.
Well, the guts to go and get, you know, have your opportunity, because I mean, La La Land was relatively inexpensive also to, you know, do a studio budget, bigger, but slightly budget, bigger budget movie, and then make something that is intimate and not something that is the easy thing to make.
Right.
It's not easy, but it's
right.
the more obvious thing to make, I guess,
right.
is very daring for a filmmaker.
Right. And to me, I think the one...
You've been kind of on a magic run because all your films so far have been about something.
Yeah, I've been, you know, very lucky.
And you've made them, you know. We've had three films in 4 years that you know.
And look, I've been very lucky. I think that if I have a frustration with this season, it's that I'm shocked that more people aren't giving props to Damien for taking his, you know, chits at the table
yeah.
and putting them down on this. So in other words, you know. For a director to take all of what he's got, you know, and to try to do something this daring with a studio film, to me, that deserves all the props in the world.
Well, I assume you don't know that I have retired from journalism primarily. Actually, this is the only thing that's journalistic that I'm doing, is these interviews, which
yeah.
I kind of feel are agnostic, really.
Yeah, yeah.
And having come from the outside and now consulting on movies, what I knew before is even clearer now, which is that so much of it is defined by the, you know, how people go about selling these movies and how yeah. they fit into the award season and all yeah. the pieces. And it really has, it doesn't have nothing to do with the movies. The movies have right. to do their part, as it were.
Sure.
But even the best movie, without the stuff that, you know, the pieces falling together in the right way.
Right.
Is very, very hard pressed to break through.
Right.
And
I think that's where my frustration with the my frustration with this, you know, and this is probably a better offline conversation, but well, you can keep the camera rolling for now. I think my frustration with, you know, the awards derby of that is the 6 months bubbles up, because it shouldn't be about that, right?
Right.
It shouldn't be about the pieces falling into place. It shouldn't be about, you know, the right moment and the right timing and everything else. It should be about, I think it should be about the artistic ambition and effort and what's groundbreaking cinema.
Right.
And to me, that's what... And again, I sort of leave myself out of the program, right? As a screenwriter, if you're working with somebody like Damien, right, you're a lieutenant storyteller, right? And it's a great role, right? Because you know whatever you put on the page is going to be that much better because Damien's
right.
shooting it. But
Steven didn't suck either. But
no. Right? No, I mean, no, it's Damien, Steven, Tom,
yeah.
Bill Condon. Like, I've had, you know, dream upon dream upon dream, right? You know, I think Damien in particular right now is just doing things that nobody else is doing. And I think what is, you know, again, it's where, you know, to me, in an ideal world, right, a season that's about awards would reward groundbreaking effort in cinema.
Right.
And that's what it would be focused on.
Though, what, to be honest, what's complicated about it is that for some people, that's Ryan Coogler and Black Panther. And, you know, it's a great movie, but it's also a Marvel movie. It's a lot of other things that are not groundbreaking, but it's beautifully made and whatever. And so people, those things shift.
And
it's
look,
weird. And Damien also, the other thing that's interesting about Damien is that with your other three filmmakers, he's a generation younger than all of them.
Right.
You know, I think that Tom is probably the youngest of that group, but Tom and Bill are around the same age and Steven's a little older.
Yeah.
But, Damien's another generation younger.
Yeah.
And so his ambitions and his lust for you know, doing what's new for him and not doing the same thing again and not is glorious.
Yeah.
And we should be celebrating that. And we should be celebrating Ryan Coogler doing all the work he's done and not just, you know, whether you're a Black Panther person or not. But it's a challenging thing when it comes down to five directors and, you know, eight movies.
Right. And maybe there should be more, you know, but I would say, and look, I'm not saying Ryan Coogler wouldn't be on my list. You know, I love Black Panther. I guess what I'm saying is, you know, I just think, especially with a young director, right?
Yeah.
When you've got a young guy like Damien who has the potential to actually create, to have a new vision, right? To create a body of work like a Marty, like a Steven, right? I mean, that's where I think we are with Damien. I think this is his fourth film, his third studio release, you know, and in the same way as, you know, to me, it's funny, like, you go back and you look at, you know, if you could go back now and give Marty the Oscar for Raging Bull or The Departed,
right?
You'd give him the Oscar for Raging Bull.
Though I love The Departed, but yes.
I mean,
the thing is, though, that Marty, it took an awfully long time for Marty to get into that cycle.
100%.
Of being one of the guys who's nominated every time.
100%.
You know, Damien's already had quite a lot of success.
No question. I think it's just for me, like,
Spike wishes he had, I mean, Spike did amazing things,
100%,
and did not get the credit when he was younger.
And look, and in some ways, I think that's my issue. Is, you know, we should be, I believe that we should be, as a community, you know, seeking out those filmmakers and elevating them.
Yeah.
And by the way, like, Coogler is a great example. Like, I hope all the awards come to him this year, right? Like, you know, he's a young guy and he's done great bang up work, and like, you know, and it is groundbreaking, right? But I just, you know, for me at least, you know, anyway.
Well, the whole thing has become less than it should be about celebrating the work, and too much about the structure of a season.
Correct.
And the Academy date feeds the Golden Globes date, feeds the, you know, BFCA date, feeds the Golden Globes date.
Correct.
And it's just like, it becomes this machinery where you have New York Film Critics, for instance, which is nothing against their picks, but they, you know, they're doing their awards in November.
Right.
And like, you're doing year-end awards in November, and critics also complain about not having enough time to see everything.
Right.
So why are you doing your awards in November? Well, because they need to get, literally, they need to get their program to the printer to have their dinner in early January, when those people are going to be in New York the other award show, and then before they come out here for the Globes, and they can't get ads in time if they do it in mid-December. So it's like everything suddenly becomes earlier and earlier, and it's like we've got this very jammed up notion. And I've been saying for a while now, the Academy Awards are basically decided in June.
Right.
By people we don't even know.
Right.
You know, nobody even knows who's doing it, but the studios are making decisions, dates are being picked.
Right.
For, you know, what film festivals, all that kind of stuff is being decided, and then some of it's out of their hands, but part those decisions have a lot to do with it.
Huge.
And they shouldn't.
Huge.
And it should be about the movie. The movie should be the Eastwood movie that's coming out. I haven't seen it yet, but people seem to like it very much. The fact that it's coming out December 15th shouldn't preclude it from getting nominated.
Sure.
But the fact that it's coming out December 15th tells you it's not getting nominated. And it doesn't, it's not, whether the movie's good or not is a different conversation, but it shouldn't be a movie that should be able to come out and be premiering on December 15th and be part of things. if it's a good enough movie.
Right. I mean, look at The Post last year. And yeah. Granted, like, we couldn't have gotten that movie out any faster.
But, right.
You know, I dare say, I think if the movie had been out earlier, there's no question we would have had a different trajectory through award season.
Yeah.
And look, I'm not saying we would have won. I'm just saying, you know, I think Meryl would have gotten nominated for SAG. You know,
well, and there's a different energy. Things. There's a different. I mean, and there's 100%. Also people who drop. You know, like what happened to, you know, La La Land. If it had come out at a different date, might not have happened because they didn't have as much time to kind of build up a thing against it being the front runner.
Correct.
Or whatever.
Correct.
All those things are in play,
right.
Positive and negative.
Right.
Steven and Clint are really, and Marty are the three people who really can get a movie seen that opens in December.
Right.
Generally.
Right.
But if it doesn't have the. If it's not the exact movie people were looking for to fill the slots that they weren't, that were not
right.
open,
right.
It doesn't go there.
Right. Right.
So it's a very strange anti-art kind of thing.
Yeah.
And at the same time, there's something thrilling about 6,000 people who are in the industry, or say 8,000 people now, embracing any, you know, embracing something.
No, that's true.
So it's a weird dichotomy. Maybe there's a movie in that, but nobody would ever make it.
Yeah, it's, you know.
Once Betty Davis died, you can't make that movie anymore.
Yeah, exactly. That's funny.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like it was a very intense journey for you. Yeah.
Super intense. And it's one of those things that, like, it took 4 years. I mean, like, this movie really took 4 years. We did, you know, one of the things, Isaac Klausner, one of our producers, made me do this. So I put in here, these are all the drafts, right?
Here, I'm going to push I'm not normally doing with this camera, but I'm going to do it for you. Because...
And what's amazing is these aren't even really all the drafts. So what I have in here, I have the 72-page outline that I first wrote, which was about 6 months after I started work. And then I have all the writer's drafts. These were just the drafts that went to producers. Now, for each of these, Damien and I did two or three drafts. So there are 16 of these producer drafts. So multiply that by two or three. So we're probably at like 40, you know. Mm-hmm. And then we had the 12 drafts or so that we did two drafts in prep, and then another 12 or so that we did in production. And then we did a couple drafts in post because there was a ton of ADR stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you're looking at least 50 drafts, probably 70, 75. I mean, it was a ton of work, you know. And... you know, a lot of this revision was at Damien's behest or Ryan's behest.
Right.
But a lot of it was also just trying to get accurate. Because this stuff is not stuff you can very quickly... it literally took me... You know, I couldn't read the Lunar Surface Journal, which is incredibly useful. But I couldn't even read it until I was up to a level of, like, understanding enough about the mission...
What they were saying.
And what was going on and what they were saying that I could actually then start to interact
like another
with
language,
it and find it
I
useful.
Guess.
And it's literally, I joke, like, I had to get to, like, graduate level in space history before I could read the Apollo Lunar Surface Journal and before, like, First Men on the Moon, which is a great site, was useful to me at all.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you need to... there's a whole education that needs to happen. So now my curse is that I will be a space geek forever. Like, I just, you know, like, I was hanging out with a bunch of space historians, and I'll get into it with them now, right? Mm-hmm. I went to the Smithsonian and literally was like, it was this plenary session. And like, you know, look, a lot, they know more than me, but some I know more than them because
right.
I've spent more time studying Neil Armstrong than just about anyone other than Jim Hansen. So like, you know, and I tend to go pretty deep. So, you know, to me, I find it all pretty fascinating. And it just makes me, you know, again, like, I read about the Virgin Galactic flight this morning,
mm-hmm.
just because it's what's so interesting is, oh, so they're basically just trying to make an X-15 safe for, you know, tourists, right? which is like, okay.
It's a new ride at Disney World.
Yeah, I mean, I get it. You know, what's amazing is we had that technology 50 years ago, 60 years ago. And I think that is the one sadness for me is, you know, we went so far, right? From the Wright brothers in 1903, 4.
Mm-hmm.
To, you know, 1969, you know, Neil says it in the movie, you know, we've come so far in 60 years, it's amazing.
Yeah.
And then look at what we've done since, and, you know, we're moving, we're progressing, but,
right.
you know, and what I think we don't quite ever understand is how valuable that work has been, right? How much we've learned about ourselves by going out there. And some of that we've been able to do with, you know, unmanned probes.
Right.
But some of that is literally looking back and, you know, and I mean, like all the data we have on climate change, all the best data comes from NASA.
Mm.
Right. So it just,
Right now though, I kind of figure we have to focus on keeping ourselves alive before we go exploring anything else at the moment.
For, you mean in terms of climate change?
Yeah. If our planet could make sure to save itself for the next 10 years before we.
Sure.
Send ourselves to Mars.
Sure. You know, although we may need to go.
Yeah. Maybe time.
Yeah.
This is my new beachfront home.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
I'm 10 miles from the beach, but
seriously,
you know,
if the water level is high, it could be perfect.
Yeah.
So,
and you're working on 5 different scripts at the same time now, or are you slowing yourself down a little bit?
You know, I will say one of the I've been very blessed to you know, be able to work on things I really care about. About the time I was hired to write First Man, I was also hired to write a movie about Leonard Bernstein, which got put a little bit back burner because this wound up, because Damien was so serious about this, and this was clearly on a trajectory, ballistic trajectory, if you will. But I managed to finish a script of that, and
which one is it? You can. Who's the star of this one? Which one?
Bradley Cooper.
Okay.
Bradley and I are working on. I mean, we'll see what happens. But Bradley and I are working on the script.
Okay.
And he's terrific. I mean, yes. I'm a huge fan of his movie as
Speaking
well.
Of people who are in the game this year.
And look, you know, I mean, I think very much deservedly so. I mean, you know, he's clearly a terrific director, and I think one of our greatest actors working today. And I think for me, that performance in that movie is, and it's funny because the movie gets talked about for all these other reasons, mm-hmm. Lady Gaga, his direction, but to me, his performance is just, you know, hands down. It's you know, look, I love Ryan's performance. I'd say, you know, Ryan's performance and his performance are the best of the year that I've seen, hands down.
One of the things I love about him is that, you know, I saw 4 or 5 movies ago how much he was committed to ultimately getting to this moment.
Yeah.
So the amount of time he spent in people's cutting rooms and asking questions and learning cameras and everything else.
Yeah. He's clearly...
This is his moment to come to.
Yeah, and he's clearly incredibly smart. He's been studying it for a long time. So, frankly, working on a script with him is a joy. He's super smart and super intense, and we both, you know, it's amazing because it took me like 4 years to learn all that I know about Lenny, and he already knows as much as I do, if not more. So, but the back and forth is just a ton of fun,
mm-hmm.
and the music is great, and trying to figure out how to make that movie work is a great, fun challenge. And so there's that. I'm writing another movie for Damien, this great story about this Yemeni peace activist who managed to be pulled out of the Yemeni civil war by a bunch of millennials who found him online and decided they weren't going to let him die there.
Mm.
It's a pretty great sort of social network Argo-y type of story.
Another easy picture.
Yeah, exactly. although this one, it's a yarn. I mean, it's got a motor. So.
Yeah.
And then I'm working on a pilot about the Oval Office. So it's an anthology series about crises in democracy.
Wow.
All through the lens of the Oval. So different president, different administration every year.
Yeah.
Looking at a, you know, very specific period of time within their presidency when there was a major league crisis.
I'm just looking forward to them getting the pee stains out of the carpet.
About the what?
Getting the pee stains out of the carpet after this one.
Right.
But that's a whole other conversation. This is when I start getting thumbs down on YouTube, is every time anybody brings up Trump, it becomes a thumbs down party.
That's hilarious.
Thank you so much.
Good
seeing
you.
Congratulations. Show the book once again.
Yeah. So
there are a lot of...
Annotated screenplay, if you're interested.
There are a lot of screenplays out there, but this one is... it looks like you've done a lot more work to get this.
We have.
It's not just the... just of words. It's
exactly.
The ideas behind it.
Exactly.
Okay. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Did I get too political in the middle of all that?
No, you were great.